Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Compensation Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of compensation that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 9th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, compensation principles. You've got some good questions about compensation principles. It's interesting that there's one point in particular that bothers you a lot, because so, there's about 10 questions all about the same thing. So we'll have to actually answer that one, won't we? But let's have a look at the compensation principles before we get to our questions about them. Compensation principles. Let's have a look at some notes about them. Again, they're will-based, so we'll be discussing them in relationship to the human soul, just like we did with all of the other order-based principles. And remember, the human soul, not the spirit body or the physical body, is the self-aware being. So we're talking specifically about the soul and the way in which it is involved in the compensation principles. Of course, compensation principles, like all of the other order-based principles, apply to all creation. But we're going to examine them particularly from the perspective of the free will being, the human soul. So let's remind ourselves of some of the terms. The self-responsibility term is very important here. So remember, that was the law-based requirement of self-awareness and to seek truth, love, and understanding of all the principles of love. So this attitude of seeking, wanting to know, is actually a law-based requirement. Does that make sense? And it's also promoted in all of the laws. But it is actually a law-based requirement. There are penalties associated with not wanting to know. So we need to understand that. So let's look at compensation. So compensation is the reward provided to the soul and its environment for self-responsibility. That being the definition of self-responsibility. Or the corrective penalty enforced upon the soul and its environment for the disobedience or lack of self-responsibility. So as we wanted to point out to you this whole order-based session, you can see our hierarchy built on scope. Hierarchy made governance possible as an automatic part of the soul's function. Governance. Making governance possible means there needs to be now some self-responsibility added, and self-responsibility is added because of the human will, the human being, the only being that can exercise its own will. And so self-responsibility is now added, so the responsibility principles are added, and now if you merge the responsibility principles with the governance principles and the hierarchy principles, we see that there needs to be some kind of effect that is a measure that can be measured by the human soul that tells it when it's in or out of harmony with those principles, and that's the compensation principle. Compensation principle provides the results for you so that you can measure what you've done. So it's the reward provided for self-responsibility or the penalty enforced for a lack of self-responsibility. Does that make sense? Very clear. So let's look at the compensation principle itself. What do? They educate the soul about sin. So say, without compensation principles, you wouldn't know what a sin is and what a sin isn't. Right? Compensation gives you the ability to know a sin, and a sin is every time there's a painful result from something that's out of harmony with self-responsibility, then of course that's what we get the soul educated about sin now. It provides reward or correction to the soul. Right? So reward being rewarded for the thing that's in positive harmony with self-responsibility, and correction is the thing that happens when we're out of self-responsibility with regard to the soul, out of harmony with God's principles. It ensures self-responsibility is the measure for compensation. So self-responsibility is measured, and the person is suitably compensated, either positively or correctively, for the positively if it's in harmony and negatively if out of harmony. So we can think self-responsibility is the measure, is the key part there. It's the yardstick via which compensation is measured. So it forces the highest creation to be responsible and accountable for its actions. And so it should be, should it not? If we're going to become a self-aware, self-actualizing being, we need to ensure that that particular being is completely accountable for all of its actions. Otherwise, it could go off and do a whole heap of very damaging things and not even ever be accountable for them. And that would be disastrous to the other creations. So it does need to be accountable. So this compensation principles enforce accountability. And it compensates consistently and predictably according to the soul's actual level of self-responsibility. So if you've got the same level of self-responsibility as another person and it's exactly the same, then you'll be compensated exactly the same way. If everything was exactly the same under all those circumstances, everything according to permanence is going to be the same. So this is the beauty of it. It's not like hit and miss. It's not like, oh, you're my favourite, so I'll give you more. It's not like, oh, I don't like the look of your face, so you know, I'm going to take away more things from you. None of that. None of that will happen. Fortunately, hey, that's a good thing, because if it was inconsistent and unpredictable, sometimes it would work, sometimes not. Sometimes it depends on your character, your nature, or might depend on just someone having a bad day, just like it was with mum and dad, right? And that would be disastrous to you being able to measure the results of the compensation. So it needs to be predictable and measurable and consistent. So that's what it does. Great idea, eh? Don't you think? Now, for many of you, this is where you have some doubts about God, to be honest. You don't believe God is going to compensate other people in a penalty-based system for the things they've done wrong towards you. Many of you don't believe that will happen. And that's one reason why you stay angry. Because you want to take out what you feel needs to be taken out against those people. So that's a problem. But then on the other hand, we often don't feel that we'll be rewarded for the good things that we did either. You know, we have that belief too. Just like in our childhood, we're often the good things we did got completely ignored. Right, so we have many problems with this principle. And as a result, we act out many behaviours that are out of harmony with love through the process of not really understanding compensation principles. So let's go to examples. We go back to our common example of gravity and aerodynamics. Compensation is provided through the form of physical, emotional, and spiritual pleasure or pain for obedience or disobedience to the laws. So we illustrated that, remember, the other day, yesterday, when we were talking about other parts of this, like self-responsibility and governance and the other parts of the order-based principles. So I don't feel there's any more need probably to cover much more about that here. You can see quite clearly that you have a reward if you obey, and if you don't obey, there's a penalty. And depending on the intention of the soul, depends upon the type of penalties and the type of rewards. So you can intend to obey but accidentally disobey, or you can intend to disobey but obey, and all of those things will be measured and duly compensated for positively. When I say positively, it's all positive, of course, because correction is positive, isn't it? Many of us just don't view correction as positive, because in our childhood, whenever correction was given, it was usually given along with punishment, violence, or ridicule, wasn't it? And so when we have a correction as adult under those systems, we then think it's not positive. But the reality is it is positive. Correction is positive. And God has no intention to ridicule you, none whatsoever. And God has no intention to violently harm you either. So it's just a penalty reward-based system without all of that unloving emotion projection in the process. So the amount of compensation is applied consistently based upon the level of self-responsibility and the intention of the individual. This is what applies to, we saw all that yesterday, so you can see that quite clearly. Compensation principle is quite clear there. Let's look at the law of cause and effect. Great law because it amalgamates five of the primary principles we've discussed, along with all the other principles, of course. Remember, all of the principles often involved in one law. This is the law of cause and effect. It amalgamates in particular everything from scope to what we're discussing now, compensation, and everything that we've discussed in between. So it ensures individuals are compensated for the cause that exists within them based upon their level of self-responsibility, not just on the effect. So the purpose of compensation is to adjust the attitude, the emotional attitude, the intention within the individual. That's its purpose. It's not just to adjust your behaviour, and this is where many of you have got trapped by the human law hangover, because you just say, oh, I did the wrong thing, I'll do the right thing now, but the feeling in you is still like, I want to do the wrong thing. It's the same as a child, and you know when it's wrong with a child, when the child goes up and he hits his friend, you know, and you say sorry to him, say sorry to him. And he looks at mum and dad going, say sorry to him, and thinks, yeah, I probably need to be sorry, otherwise I might get a hit myself. So he goes back up, says sorry, but is he sorry? Probably not, right? Because he wanted to do it in the first place, and that's not being addressed. He's not sorry. But you're telling him just to act sorry. Right? Now, God doesn't do that. God's not trying to get you to act differently. He's trying to get you to feel differently, to feel like you're sorry, and to also feel like you don't want to carry on that action anymore. That's what he's trying to address. So the law of cause and effect has been specifically created from the human soul's perspective to ensure that you understand the cause is an emotional feeling, a desire within your soul that has to be adjusted. That's his purpose, to adjust your desire from a desire to sin to a desire to live in love. That's the purpose from God's perspective. So the individual is educated about the relationship between causes and effects and can take actions to remove causes. If I can see the cause, I can remove it, right? So God's trying to expose the cause so that you can remove it. Remember, he does not have control over you removing it, because that's you. You've got control of that, right? So he doesn't have control of that. You do. But God's trying to help you get to the stage where you want to remove it, right? Where you have a feeling inside of you that you would really love to remove it. That's what he wants to have happen, hence the law. Let's have a look at another one, the compensation law. Obviously, the compensation law involves principles of compensation, but it also involves the principles of will, desire, scope, hierarchy, responsibility, and it merges it into a single complete law system applied to the soul and in a secondary manner to all creation. And when I say in a secondary manner, all creation without the soul is compensated positively for its actions in harmony with love. And in fact, all creation without the human soul being involved automatically, instinctually desires to satisfy the principles of its own creation and therefore is automatically in harmony with God's laws and principles. But as soon as you add soul to the mix, because of governance, the soul being the pinnacle of the governance tree, if you like, the pinnacle of the hierarchy, aside from God, of course, the soul now imposes its law upon creation. And so in a secondary manner, the compensation effect is trying to benefit all creation by helping the soul change its behaviour so that it can get back to loving behaviour. So then all creation will benefit from its loving behaviour, from the soul's loving behaviour. So that's the point of it. Again, very loving law provided by God. And it doesn't matter if you know about it or not. At the end of the day, you will know about it. Trust me. There are plenty of people in the spirit world who try to ignore that law. And in the hills, they discovered that it's real. And it applies to them as it applies to everyone else. Provides rewards and corrections to the soul. Correction is a reward, really, isn't it? Don't you think? Yeah. Eventually you'll feel that way. Law of repentance. Repentance is God's desired attitude from the human towards disobedience to law. So when you disobey a law, what God's looking for is that you're sorry for what you've done. Just like you looking for that in your own children, right? When you see them do something that's out of harmony with love and you know it to be out of harmony with love, don't you desire that they change that behaviour? But not only that they change the behaviour, that they feel sorry for what they've done, that they actually feel repentant for what they've done. Well, that's what God's trying to encourage in you, the same attitude. So that's a part of its motivation. And then it provides the measure whether something is good or bad. So we now have sort of like a scales. So compensation is often considered to be like scales, measuring things. And in fact, don't we see that as the word justice, where the scales are even, right? And the reality is compensation is God's justice. It provides the framework for justice in God's entire universe. Very, very clear principles, aren't they? Do you have any questions about it before we consider it? Rita, you would like to ask?
I don't understand that. How can we take actions to remove causes? I thought only God can remove causes with the law of repentance.
No, we can remove causes.
Can you give an example?
Yeah, well, let's say you sin, right? And the sin, let's say the sin is that you lied, right?
Yeah.
So we sinned and the sin is that we lied. Now in the lie, we've broken quite a number of principles, haven't we? We've broken the love principle, the truth principle, the permanence principle. We're obviously not taking self-responsibility because we're not in harmony with the truth about what we really feel. So there's quite a lot of principles we've broken, as well as the compensation principle. Now the law of cause and effect says that God is going to try to help you understand the reason why you lied, but God's not going to remove from you the reason why you lied. You have to choose to remove from you the reason. Now, what are the reasons why we lie? Sometimes it's for personal benefit. Sometimes it's because of fear.
Or to protect another one.
Or so-called protect, but it's not really protection. But it's a belief in the false concept of protection. So sometimes there's a number of different motivations why we might lie. Does that make sense? Now, what God is trying to do is expose that we've lied and also expose the reason why we lied. But he's not going to remove the reason why we lied. We have to do that. We have to choose to deal with the fear that causes us to lie, or the false belief that we have that we're protecting people, or whatever it is that caused us to lie. We have to address that ourselves. Now, we can enlist God's assistance to do that, or we can do it ourselves by releasing the emotional cause as to why we chose to lie. We can do it either way. God only is interested in the end that we do it. Now, God would love us to involve him in the process of removing it if that's what we want, but at the end of the day, he doesn't force that on us, but he does require that we remove it. He does require we do that. The law requires it, in fact. And hence the law of cause and effect allows us to trace the cause. And then it requires from us that we take the steps of removing the reason why we sinned from ourselves. Does it make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
Yep. So that's what it does. It's a very positive, powerful process that's trying to get right down into our heart, reach right down into it, and that little bit of mess that's there in that heart, to grab it and yank it out of us. So we don't ever do the same thing again. That's God's goal. And it's very economical when you think about it, because if you get rid of that cause, you will not do it again. You just won't. In the same circumstances, same situation, you're going to do something completely different. You're going to act in harmony with the law now instead of out of harmony like you did before, if the cause is removed. But if the cause isn't removed, you put yourself in a similar situation again, what will you do? Exactly the same thing. That's the trouble, you see, and that's why God has these laws based on the compensation principle. Sorry about that. Slight misspoke there. And I suppose a lot of us are pretty constipated when it comes to this principle. We're pretty, should we say, anally retentive about it. And the reality is that we are frequently attempting to avoid it. And in fact, when it comes to human law, some of us have become experts at avoiding the possible consequences of our behaviour and actions, haven't we? We lie here, misplace the truth there, you know, tell people things that are only half the truth in order to get away with things. We do all sorts of things, but none of that is possible with God. God's laws are exact. They find the exact feeling we have and they address it, which is actually very good for us in the end. So let's just go through to the conclusion, because we wanted to see some things that we need to learn about the principles themselves. So they ensure, the compensation principles ensure that I become aware of and are compensated for the manner in which I engage self-responsibility. They are linked to scope, hierarchy, governance and responsibility, and they form a foundation for God's highest principles for the human soul, including redemption, is all part of this process. So compensation principles form a foundation for redemption of the human soul. Now, what we do, again, is we justify, minimise the attitudes, desires and emotions, thoughts and actions that oppose these principles by feeling that disobedience, feeling that disobedience will never be penalised and corrected. Most of us have that feeling, you know, that as long as we sin in private, we feel that pretty much we'll get away with everything. Does that make sense? But we also have this understanding, too, that if I do good things, nobody ever notices. And that's not true either. God notices every one of the good things you've done, even if nobody else on the planet notices anything. Isn't that wonderful too? So that means that instead of having to do good things just because you want people to acknowledge it, if you're motivated by a pure heart and you do good things just because you feel they're right to do, then God will reward every one of those acts of goodness that you engaged. Now, whether you perceive the reward on earth or not, you will definitely perceive it when you arrive in the spirit world. Even your own house will be a reflection of those good things that you did. Yeah? You'll have pictures of you doing the good thing on your wall, even though nobody else saw it, right? Your soul, it's very interesting, God's got these laws in the spirit state that the picture gets painted while you're doing it. Isn't that amazing? So you arrive in your home in the spirit world and you look in the wall and say, I remember doing that. And then you look at another painting, it's, oh, I remember doing that. You know, and everyone's got a lesson in them. It's really wonderful, actually. It's a great way of being able to see, you know, the good things and the negative things that you've done. If we feel we can sin with impunity, so we minimise and justify sinning, because we feel that we can get away with it, no one's really going to sort us out with it. So that's an indication that we're ignoring the compensation principle, that we've got an issue with it, right? We feel that we only sin if we act. You know, there's this common idea that if you get your sexual appetite anywhere, but go home and make sure you have sex with your wife or husband, right? There's no sin in that, according to people. Well, that's not the case with God. Where you get your sexual appetite matters to God. Does that make sense? So these are the examples. Complaining about the negative compensation effects that the person has created through their own free will choices. So in other words, you get a disease which is created through your own free will and the choices you've made. You get a disease and instead of seeing your own self as the cause of it, what do? We blame society because they don't have a cure yet. We blame, you know, God for creating it that way. What terrible disease have you put upon us, God? And we get angry about people in the world, but it's all just our own choice that caused this particular problem in the end. So how can we really be blaming anyone else? We can't, can we? But we do. And that's another demonstration of the ignorance of ourselves towards this principle, the compensation principle. That makes sense? So you can see these principles, you know, there's a lot of ways we're breaking them, a lot of ways that they're actually creating damage in our lives. These principles, not understanding them and not engaging them appropriately, causes us to do a whole heap of things while ignoring the compensation of those things. And we also neglect to do a lot of good things because we don't believe we will be rewarded for the good things. So can you see, this introduces a concept of the two types of sins. The sins of, can you remember, we've discussed them in the past, but let's write down the two of them. There's the sins of omission. Is that how you spell it, with two M's? No? Yes? One M. By believing you one M persons, I may be gullible, and commission. Two M's. I'm confused. Are you? Is it two S's as well? No. You trying to trick me? What are you talking about? I'm sure it's two, isn't it? Yes. Okay. So we have sins of omission and sins of commission. And compensation principles measure both types of sins. Omission is when we neglect love or truth. So a sin of omission would be, you know the truth about something, you know it would benefit the law or anybody who knew it, and you're asked it, but you say you just don't know. There's a neglect of love and truth. It's a sin of omission. You've failed to tell the truth when actually God's laws require that you do. Does that make sense? Yep. Commission is a sin where you purposefully are unloving or untruthful. Now, as you can see, your definition of loving should be expanding quite widely by now, because obviously love is in every one of these principles. And your definition of untruthful should be expanding quite widely now, because truth is actually in every one of these principles as well. So you could actually say purposefully are disobeying God's principles. And here you neglect to obey God's principles. Can you see? So if I neglect to obey God's principles, it's a sin of omission. If I purposefully disobey God's principles, it's a sin of commission. Both sins are measured by the law of compensation. So a lot of people arrive in the spirit world saying, I didn't do anything. And God says, that's the reason why you're where you are, because you didn't do anything. That make sense? Yeah. Yeah. So that's also part of the compensatory principles that we need to see. Now, is there any questions about that before we move on? That's good. Well, what we might do then, since we've covered the main material we need to cover, we'll have just a pause for a minute or two, and while we change to our Q&A, and we'll start answering your questions on the subject. So what we're going to be doing is now covering the compensation principles Q&A. So obviously, you know, we've seen the compensation principles that we've talked about, the other principles we've talked about. It's about the measure being self-responsibility. We'll pop back to this slide as we answer some of these questions. So we're interested in things like the terms as well as what the questions are about. So you can ask any of the questions about what they are, how they apply to law, the laws affected, what does it reveal about God, and all those kind of things can be asked as well. So let's just pop back to the definition and we'll fire away with your number one question. Actually, can I have your number two question first?
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you mean under the definition the law shall ensure self-responsibility is the measure for compensation, self-responsibility is the yardstick or barometer for receiving the compensation, and I did that graph.
Yes, you've done a nice little neat graph on the side there, I see that.
Oh, was it right?
Well,
I just gave it a shot because you help us out with graphs to understand. I thought I'll try it.
Yeah, I'll draw the graph you draw and we'll see how we work on that, shall we? So we'll just rub that out. Okay. So the graph that Deidre drew was, so you've made this self-responsibility on the side.
Yeah, like the variable. Is that the variable axis? I can't remember, sorry.
Well, I'm going to make, let's draw it how you've drawn okay. it. I don't know if you could really draw it like this, to be honest, but
okay.
basically you're saying that if you're in the positive zone of self-responsibility, right?
Yeah.
That's positive self-responsibility, and this is obviously negative, is yep. what you're suggesting. And I'm suggesting, no, self-responsibility is really more of a either is or it is not. It's like love. A lot of you still believe in this whole concept of degrees of love. You know, I was more loving last time, this time, than I was last time. That kind of concept. Now, in 2014 assistance groups, we talked to you about this concept of more loving, less loving. And we just said something is either love or it is not love. It's not more loving or less loving. It's just either love or not love. And the same applies to self-responsibility. You're either being self-responsible or you're not at any one point in time. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. There's no such thing as I was more self-responsible this time as last time. You are either self-responsible, meeting the requirement of self-responsibility, or you're not. Anytime you're not, there'll be a compensatory effect that's in the negative zone mm-hmm. or corrective. Anytime you are, there'll be a compensatory positive zone or supportive, rewarding. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So stop thinking about it, oh, I can just have a little bit more self-responsibility. In practice, that is true to a degree. You have a little bit more self-responsibility, there'll be some rewards from that. But the reality is you're aiming for complete self-responsibility. That's your aim. Right. Just like you're aiming for, I am loving. Right. All the time. And I'm recognizing when I'm not, and when I'm not, I'm not. It's not like, what a lot of you do is you go, I wasn't loving, but I was more loving than I was last time. And I go, well, that makes no logical sense. You were either loving or you were not loving. What is it?
Yeah, you either lied or you told the truth.
Exactly. Yeah. And you can say, but I only told a little lie, so I'm less,
so
more loving.
So it's pretty black and white.
It's pretty black and white, yeah.
Right.
So is
gotcha.
What I'm suggesting, right?
Yeah.
And God's laws are all black and white. So let's rub out the concept that God's laws are in the grey zone and let's make it digital. Isn't it like digital? Digital is a zero or a one.
Ah.
One being I'm self-responsible, zero being
I'm not.
I'm not. Does that make sense? Yeah. So God's laws are more digital than variable, more than analog, in the sense you're either doing it or you're not doing it, then you're measured on that. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yep. So we've got to get away from this concept that it's all just a smidge more and I can... You know, the trouble with doing this smidge more thing, you know, this little bit more and little bit less thing, is that you finish up justifying a lot of pretty poor behaviour in the underlying analysis, right? So the question is, do you mean under the definition the law is ensures self-responsibility is a measure for compensation, that line there, do I mean that self-responsibility is the yardstick?
Yes,
I do.
Yeah, right.
Yes, I do. So in other words, if you're not self-responsible, and remember self-responsible is not just about, because remember, go back to our self-responsibility, wrong way, self-responsibility definition, it's about seeking. It's not just about doing or thinking you're doing or whatever. It's about having this heartfelt feeling of wanting to do, which is a seeking attitude, right? It's about wanting to find out, wanting to know. Yeah. So that's a very important distinction than just finding out or knowing, isn't it, through accident or finding out because you're forced to. This is wanting to know, wanting to find out, wanting to no longer be ignorant, right? That's the one we're aiming for.
Right.
Right, the doing of self-responsibility. So when we say it's the yardstick, you can see straight away that that definition is quite refined, isn't it, from an emotional perspective, because it's actually implying that if I'm only doing it to get the result, then am I really seeking? Right? So the attitude God's looking for here is a seeking heart, a heart that wants to know, that is sincere and wants to have not just the result, but wants to do it no matter what the result.
So you're not doing it out of fear of punishment or penalty, but you want to,
yes.
You're desiring to.
Yes.
Right.
That's the measure of self-responsibility.
Uh-huh.
All right. Can you see straight away many of you are not meeting that mark? Because you're doing it because you're afraid.
Yeah.
You're doing it because you think you have to.
Yep.
Not because you want to.
Yeah, totally.
So God's trying to get you to the stage where you actually want to. Now, part of wanting to is understanding the benefits for doing it and understanding the pain when you don't do it. That's a part of wanting to, but it's not the only motivation, is it? Sometimes we've got to learn that we want to because it's the right thing to do, because it's the truthful thing to do, because it's the loving thing to do. That's why you do it. Even if the world around you thinks that you should be punished for what you did, you still do it. Even if the world around you disagrees with you doing it, you still do it. Even if the world around you disapproves you and ridicules you and says you're stupid and an idiot and makes fun of you, you still do it. That's a person who wants to, isn't it? And can you see that's greatly linked to this concept of desire then, which we have to talk about in a lot more detail, right? So yes, very important to understand. So that's number one, yes. The measure of self-responsibility is this attitude of wanting self-awareness, wanting truth, wanting love, wanting to live in harmony with the principles. There are times when you'll fall short. But even when you fall short, as long as you have the attitude of wanting to, God still thinks you have a number one on the self-responsibility.
Because I'm going to make mistakes as I learn.
You're going to make mistakes, and God's not going to criticize those mistakes if you want to, right? He's only going to criticize the mistakes that were made if you didn't want to, because that's no longer one on the self-responsibility. That's now zero on the self-responsibility. You follow?
Yep.
Yep. So understand that here God is allowing you to make mistakes and he's still thinking you want to be a self-responsible being. So he's not going to penalize that. Can you see why there's no worries about making mistakes? It's beautiful, isn't it? We don't have to worry about making mistakes. This is fantastic. But we do have to worry about whether we have the attitude that we don't want to make mistakes, that we don't want to do something that's unloving. That's the attitude that God's aiming to correct. You follow? So for this reason, God is very compassionate about the fact that you made a mistake. And sure, some of the mistakes might have broken a law here and a law there, but when you want to understand, that'll be fine for you. You follow? When you want to understand, it feels good, doesn't it? That you still go, oh, you know, that law showed me that I did the wrong thing there. And the fact that I wanted to know is the thing God wants me to have, the feeling God wants me to have. Yeah, it's wonderful, isn't it, Deirdre, when you think about it? Yeah. Well, Deirdre, do you want to do question number two now? You're crying, or you want to go and have a cry? Which one is it?
I can do number two.
You can do number two. I don't want to stop you from crying. Can you see how beautiful that was, though?
Yeah. Yeah, because I've recently made a mistake.
Just hold that mic with you.
Oh, sorry. I've recently made a mistake with employment. Like, yep. I wanted to start my own business, but I did it through willpower, not will. So I'm still learning what willpower and will is. So yep. I've made some mistakes in the process.
Sure, sure. So God's not going to penalise that and say that's you not taking responsibility. He's going to say, no worries, there's no penalty conversation under those circumstances. None at all. Isn't that wonderful? You don't have to worry about it. The laws themselves may have individual things that happen that give you some pain and suffering to indicate something was wrong, but there'll be no compensatory penalty on your soul, because the attitude is, I want to be more self-responsible. I want to take more self-responsibility in my life. If that's the attitude, that's rewarded. Do you follow? Many of you didn't get that, hey, from this discussion, did you? No. So it's the reason why I wanted to raise this issue with you in more detail, even though it was answered in the presentation, because it's very important that you understand it's not whether you do everything right or not that matters here. It's whether, from God's perspective, what is right is that you want to know. That's what's right. And as long as you want to know what's right, that's what God's going to reward. He calls that self-responsibility at number one. Yeah, it is awesome, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, that's good. Okay, I wanted to make sure that was clear to you guys, because many of you go, hang on a sec, self-responsibility means I'm going to get penalised every time I'm not self-responsible, and you start thinking that then means that God's going to be nitpicky about whether, you know, even if you have the right attitude, he's still going to penalise you at times. And that's not how he feels with compensation. That's not how it is with compensation. You're not going to be penalised for mistakes you made when you have an attitude that you wanted to know. You're only going to be penalised for mistakes you made that were purposeful, in addiction, unloving, directly unloving, that you didn't want to know. Right? That's no longer self-responsibility, number one. That's now self-responsibility zero. And God wants to correct self-responsibility zero. Yep. Yeah, good. Okay, number two question, which is one question that a lot have asked, so.
Can you please explain and give examples of how sins committed by me that sins committed by me affect others attract pleasurable compensation and allowances towards them, vice versa?
Yes, now what you're referring to is a slide that I hope I've got, which is the note slide, that one. And that one, isn't it? Yes. Right? You were referring to the note section. Yeah. And lots of you asked this question. So let's look at these notes that were included in the outline, but we didn't include in the presentation. So here we're saying, sins committed by others that affect me attract a pleasurable compensation and allowance towards me. What does that mean? Well, that means that if somebody does something towards me that was unloving, and then I choose to do something else from that thing that was done towards me, you know, I choose to make some other decisions and so forth, the reality is that there are more allowances given to me because something else, someone else's unloving behaviour triggered it. Does that make sense? Somebody else's unloving behaviour triggered my behaviour, so the reality is there will be allowances made for the fact that somebody else's unloving behaviour did that. So I'm actually given some, you could say, I'm let a bit off the hook for some of the things under those circumstances. Does that make sense?
Is that when we were younger?
It particularly applies to when we were children, particularly, right? So, for example, when we were children, mummy told me to lie to the next door neighbour rather than tell the truth. And then mummy punished me when I didn't lie and I told the truth to the next door neighbour. And so I learnt that lying to the next door neighbour was necessary. Right? As a child, this was. So what does God feel about that? Well, God barely penalises the child for that. What he does instead is penalises the mother for the forced behaviour upon the child. Does that make sense? And isn't that right? Of course it's right. The mother had control of the child. She probably used some method of coercion or punishment in order to force the child to be unloving. So of course that makes sense that God would do that, isn't it? And that's a part of the compensatory thing. So that's an example of a sin committed by others, the mother, that affected me as a child. And I was compensated for the fact that I went and did a few things that mummy wanted me to do, but the reality is those sins that I did would be attributed to my mother because she attempted to force me into that process. Now, of course, the level of that attribution will change depending on whether I'm a child or an adult, won't it? The older I get, the wiser I get, the more I'm driven by my own desires and attitudes, the more, if I still go ahead with what mummy tells me to do and I'm 30, now a large portion of my decision at that point is going to be attributed to me, isn't it? Because I'm now an adult who's got able to make their own decisions and able to make choices and able to determine what's right and wrong for myself. Does that make sense?
Because by that stage you know that you're lying.
You know you're lying and you've had the effects of lying on other people throughout your life, so you've seen some negative effects by that stage usually. You've seen some negative effects on your own life when other people lied to you, so you know that it feels bad. And so by that stage, the ethics inside of you should start going, well, perhaps lying's not the good thing that mummy taught me it was. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So by now, you've now got other measurable emotions that God can measure to measure how culpable you are for that lie. Does that make sense? So that's an example of that. The second one, sins committed by me that affect others trigger a pleasurable conversation allowance towards others. It's basically the flip side of this one, isn't it? But me towards others. So if I go and damage my child, right, then this is saying that my child will have allowances made for it, for the damage that I have committed towards my child. I won't be made allowances for, but my child will.
Mm. Right.
So that's good to know, because that means as a parent, when you sin as a parent, at least your child isn't always paying the same compensatory penalties that you're going to be paying for the sin.
Yeah, I was a bit stuck on pleasurable, because when I had what I had in mind was when I screamed at my brother and he was in fear.
Yeah.
How would that trigger a pleasurable compensation for him?
God is going to make an allowance for whatever that fear that got triggered in him causes him to do. And isn't that pleasurable? He's making an allowance for it rather than and he's taking it into account. Now, it doesn't mean the person feels pleasure in the moment, but it does, because unfortunately, if they did, they probably wouldn't be compensated under those circumstances. What it means is that in the future, in their future life, they will notice the pleasurable compensation because God has made allowances for the fact that pressure had been placed upon them.
Oh.
Does that make sense?
That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So in the moment, they might not feel the pleasure because all they feel from you is the attack, right?
Terror
or whatever
it
is. But God then makes allowances for the fact that you created terror in somebody else for that person. So now that terror might have caused them to do something, like they might have even hit you after that. Immediately hit you even for creating the terror. But at the end of the day, God makes allowances for that because you chose to create their terror before they hit you. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. It's fair, is it not?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. God's sense of justice, all based on compensation principles. Make sense?
Thank you.
Does that, everyone gets that? how the allowances are made. And the pleasurable compensation may not be measured by the soul at the moment the deed is done, because at the moment these deeds are done, usually pain is the thing they feel. But the pleasure will come later in the fact that they don't have to pay a penalty for the fact that they felt that pain. Does that make sense?
Yep.
God is not going to force them to feel another pain as a result, a corrective pain as a result. That will be attributed to the person who created the sin, not to the person who received the consequence of others' creation of sin. Yeah.
Thank you.
So that makes sense to everyone? Yeah. Does that help with those things? Now, quite a number of you had a lot of questions about that, but it's pretty much all the same question. So let's just go to the other two parts of this equation while we're there. Sins committed by me attract a negative penalty towards myself. So that one's pretty understandable, isn't it? You can see that if I commit a sin, then I will have a penalty. That's quite easy to see. Sins committed by any person trigger a negative penalty towards those who committed the sin. So basically that's saying that any other person other than me commits a sin, then a penalty would be attributed to them. So this is one reason why I'm not very concerned when you treat me in an unloving way. Because I know that God's compensatory system automatically has put a penalty on your soul right at that moment that you did it. That will cause a correction of some kind. It might cause it now if you're sensitive, or it might be 100 years down the track where you realise, wow, I treated Jesus pretty badly during that period. You know, and you have come to terms with that. And trust me, there's been a lot of my friends from the first century have had to go through that. It was pretty common to treat me badly because I don't react violently to your treatment. See, the average person won't treat another person badly if the other person will react violently to the treatment. Have you noticed that? The people you're scared of, you treat better. You're not very scared of me, right? Trust me. You might think you are. You are very frightened of what I say, but you're not very frightened of me. And how I know that is because many of you continue to treat me worse than you treat most of your friends and definitely most of the people in your life. Right? So I know you're not scared of me. You're only scared of what I say. And in fact, you being scared of what I say causes you oftentimes to treat me badly. Can you see that? Because you're frightened of what I might say to you, what I might expose. But you're not very afraid of me, you're only afraid of what I'll say. Can you see the difference? And when you're afraid of what somebody will say, you often get angry with the person who you're afraid of what they'll say. And if that person is not a violent person, you will freely get angry with them, thinking you're justified, and seemingly there's no penalty on you, but there is. Yeah. So these are the reasons why we can trust God and God's compensatory systems. We don't have to worry about justice. God's already got it worked out. Can you see that many of you are holding on to your negative emotions because you want justice? Can you see that? You want what you perceive to be justice, and you believe you are the person who's going to bring about this justice by holding on to your anger-based emotions. But justice is inherent in God's principles and laws. Make sense to you? And since justice is inherent in God's principles and laws, and particularly the compensation principles, it thus follows that justice is automatic in God's system of things. Isn't that wonderful too? It means I don't have to worry about punishing you. Isn't that good? It means that if I'm stuck on punishing you or wanting to punish you, that I've got a problem. It means I need to work through something emotionally, get rid of that problem because it's just weighing me down. I need to stop the desire for punishment. Many of you still have a desire for punishment, right? Yeah, particularly towards people who have harmed you. And that indicates that you do not trust the compensation principles. You have no trust of compensation in your life. Yep. Okay, now can we go to... how am I going, timers? I'll just check my times. 12 minutes. Can we go to Jen? Next, yep, you've got the mic. Okay, can you ask your question, Jen?
If our development is less, does that mean we are more under compensation law?
No, it doesn't. It means that we are always under compensation law, always. Right? There's no such thing as being more under the law or less under the law. Everyone is under the law, the same amount, doesn't matter what your development is. But the amount of compensation is proportional to the development of the individual. Obviously, the higher development you have, the less inclined you are to be breaking God's principles. You are more responsible, so you have more self-responsibility, and as a result, you are number one on the scale of self-responsibility, right? And on top of that, you have no desire to break the principles, so now you have higher development, therefore you will have more positive rewards, right? But everyone is under the system, and the system itself operates perfectly at all times, and there's no such thing as more under the law or less under the law. There is a time when you are free of the law of compensation, and that's when you engage the law of repentance. In other words, you engage the transformation and redemption laws. Then you are free of compensation. But the transformation and redemption laws we haven't covered yet, so we'll talk about those in 2 days' time.
May I ask another question?
You can.
I asked...
No, is it a question?
Yes.
Yep, fire.
Yesterday, development meaning learning.
Yep.
Does that mean that a younger person who has less learning...
capacity? Yep.
Or a disability.
Yes.
Is under compensation law.
Yes.
But
they can't exercise their will or desire as much, can they?
Different.
Yes. Remember, self-responsibility is a will or desire thing. If a person can't exercise their will or desire, or their will or desire is controlled by intellectual problems, or by them being a child and being controlled by other people's will, then naturally they have less compensatory effects for the decisions they make.
May I ask also ask?
No, I'd like to continue with another person's question now. Is that all right? Thanks. Can I go to... that's already answered. So a lot of your questions have been answered with those two things that we've discussed. Is that not true? We're trying to go to ones that have not been answered, so I'll just find those because I've just got marks here about what's answered and what isn't. Yvonne, question 3, where are you? Can we have you at question 3? Sorry, Nat. I just want to skip yours for a sec. We'll come back to yours. Yep, fire away, Yvonne.
Are the injuries of wanting others to do stuff for me all based on not wanting to be self-responsible?
Pretty much.
Okay. That's good news.
Well, I don't know. If it's good news... it's truthful news.
Okay.
And I suppose all truthful news is good news. Yeah. So, yes, the reality is when we want other people to do things for us, we are basically wanting them to be responsible for things in our life. Now, a self-responsible person doesn't do that. Doesn't do that. And they certainly don't expect other people to do things for them. And they certainly don't... the way you handle this in particular is that you feed the addictions of the other person, and then they get to feed your addictions. Now, that is really a codependent bartering system, which is both people not taking responsibility, right? So Those kind of systems need to be worked out, this codependent bartering systems where you feed the addiction of someone else so they then want to come and do something for you. Like, if I was Tony Robbins, we would have hundreds of thousands of people coming to seminars. Why is that? Because I would know how to meet their addictions and meet their addictions.
Yeah.
And they would pay me megabucks to come and appear. And interestingly, the first 2 days of this group, there's been no donations at all. Not a single one. Now, if that was happening to Tony Robbins, how do you think he would feel?
Oh, no, the money would be paid up front.
Correct. Correct. Yeah, the money would be in the kitty up front for him, yeah. So he feeds the addictions of people and they willingly pay. They willingly give him things. You follow? Yeah. So that's an indication that you know, he's feeding the addictions of others. They then feed his addiction. Does that make sense? Yeah, and this is not what conversation's about, obviously. Self-responsibility in particular is not about that, is it? It's about you being completely self-sufficient. Not self-reliable, self-sufficient. Yeah.
Yep, I won't comment.
You can ask if you want.
Oh, no.
Because I'm happy to cover that properly.
I'm only just starting to understand, like this morning, what self-responsibility really is.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, yes.
Because you spend a lot of your life trying to get men to do a lot of things that you actually need to be self-responsible for.
Mm.
And you've used codependent bartering systems that you've become adept at using to ensure that that actually happens. Does that make sense?
But it is good news for me in what you said, that it's the basis is not wanting to be self-responsible.
Yes. Yeah, because now we know how compensation is measured. Yes. We can see, wow, every time I've done that, I've got some severe compensation issues to work through there.
Mm.
You see, whereas a person who's self-responsible on the number one scale of self-responsibility, even if they make mistakes, they haven't got much to work through, have they?
That's good news too.
Yeah, that is good news, isn't it?
The binary system.
Even if they make mistakes, it's okay. Yeah. It's just their attitude that God's trying to correct,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, love isn't it. Thank you.
That's wonderful, isn't it? Yeah, so let's go back to Nat now. Thank you.
To engage the process of repentance, is it as simple as wanting to be accountable for my unloving actions and desiring to see and feel it from God's perspective?
Well, that's a part of repentance, obviously. But repentance is quite a as we at some point in the future hope to discuss, because remember, we didn't get to discuss repentance very much in our 2014 groups. And obviously, coming up, we've got the sin discussions, and obviously we're going to spend a lot of time on repentance when we do our sin discussions, all right? So we need to understand repentance very well, because and what's going to form the basis of understanding repentance is the next session, where we talk about will, desire and redemption. That's going to help us form some basis of repentance and understand repentance better. You do need to want to be accountable for your actions. But with repentance, you also need to understand when you've sinned. Because you can't be sorry for something you don't think you did. Does that make sense? And this is where many of you are running into trouble with repentance and awakening to sin. You need to have the awakening to a sin before you can repent for the sin. Now, awakening to sin means that you understand what the sin is. Now, for many of you, you still don't understand what the sin is, and through this talk already, through this group already, you should be starting to see, wow, sin's a lot more than I thought.
Oh, gosh, yes.
Because we've got all these principles that every time we break a principle, we're breaking hundreds, of, if not thousands, or even millions, and probably billions of laws all at once. So we're creating like billions of sin in that one moment, right? And this shows us how compassionate God is in a lot of ways, because still people who break billions of sins in the course of a day, which we're often doing, still don't get to go like this terrible tormenting punishment of hellfire or anything, like as the churches believe. But obviously they get to go to a darker condition in the hells until they work their way through things. but it's all corrective. And isn't that wonderful that God isn't even trying to be punitive with all of that?
Yeah.
But what I'm getting at here with regard to your question is wanting to be accountable requires that you know you want what you want to be accountable for.
So then does self-responsibility, like when you say it's that seeking to know, that's what's going to give me the awakening to what I need to be accountable for?
Correct.
Okay.
And also the awakening to what it is that's a sin and what is not a sin.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So this is a part of the process that needs to occur. The actual awakening to sin involves coming to know what a sin actually is and coming to know what the sin actually did. See, most of us ignore the results of our sins because we don't want to see the full consequence of them. We don't want to see all of the different things that they've done to ourselves and others. So we ignore the consequence of sin, therefore we haven't awakened to it. Now, an act of repentance requires the awakening to occur. Now, unless you awaken to sin, you cannot be repentant for the sin. And if you can't be repentant for the sin, you can't engage the laws of redemption. From God's perspective, you can't repent towards God. You can only go through the compensatory process, which is feeling the pain and suffering that results from the fact that you sinned.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Until the pain and suffering is complete.
Yeah.
So this is why most of us are still going through this pain and suffering compensatory process, because we're still not even haven't yet had an awakening to how we've even sinned.
Yeah.
Not we don't even know how we sinned yet.
You highlighted about like self-responsibility just made me go, I'm sinning so much here.
Yeah. And this is an area where why we wanted to labour it a bit, because this is an area where many of you are sinning so much.
Yeah.
And it is an area that needs to be corrected. The beauty of understanding the principles is that you can now understand your sin.
Yeah, and that feels good.
And now that you understand your sin, now you have something to repent for. Does that make sense? Yeah. So it's more than what you've written down. The process of being accountable is certainly important, but you need to know what you're accountable for. And this is where many of you are still clueless.
Yeah.
You're still not seeing, you know, when we point out something, well, that's actually a sin, you go, how's that a sin? I don't see that, you know.
Yeah.
Like, what's wrong with that? And this is where the cluelessness about the sin causes you then to not think that you have to repent for anything, because you don't think you did anything wrong.
Which means I'm still in pain and suffering because compensation is always in play.
Correct. And that's why there is still pain and suffering in our lives, because we're not really engaging the process yet, because we've not yet had the awakening to sin that we need to have.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. That really cleared that up.
Yeah. And I think that's good for most of you. You would have benefited from that question, I think, in terms of understanding that there is the process required of coming to an awareness of when we have actually sinned, and that is not the same as taking accountability for my unloving actions, because I need to know what I'm accountable for before I can take accountability for it. Yeah. Yep. And the beauty of this principle is that self-responsibility demands that I seek to know what I'm accountable for. Isn't that good? God's put that in there, just a little trick thing in there, just to make sure that heart's engaged, right? And that's God's goal. Remember, the heart's engaged. I'm wanting to know. I'm now self-responsible. I'm being self-responsible. Now I get positive compensatory benefits for being self-responsible. And one of those positive compensatory benefits is that I get to discover my sins a lot more quickly and therefore get to avoid them a lot more quickly than I would normally do, right? Which brings positive rewards as well. Hmm. So there's a lot of benefit to know when you're sinning. That's really what I'm getting at. Does that make sense? And that is wonderful. Once you know, then you can change something. If you don't know, you can't change anything. Yeah. All right. Well, that brings us to the conclusion of our Q&A, so that we can give Mary some time to do a bit of a review with you of this session that we've just done, the order principles session. So she'll be doing that in about 10 minutes' time. It'll be about 12 minutes past 3. So if you could come back at 12 minutes past 3 and Mary will get going on to the conclusion of our session, the order principles session. Thanks, guys.